Well, good morning, everyone. Welcome to Grace Point this morning. Beautiful morning. Glad to have you with us. If you're watching online, delighted that you are with us as well. If you're newer to Grace Point, maybe last week or in the past month, or even today being your first time, we certainly welcome you to our little family here. We just naturally include you as a part of it. But we would love to meet you. And occasionally we do this thing called Meet the Pastors. And so after this service, Pastor Jared and I'm Steve Young, one of the pastors here. We're actually going to be down on the first floor on the other side of the lobby. You'll see some little high top tables, and we're just going to be hanging out down there, and would love to have you stop by and say hello. We usually have a little card for you that you can take to a coffee shop or whatever. But we'd love to meet you. If you have any questions about our church, we would be happy to answer those for you as well. Next week, we are doing our class called Explore Grace Point. This is the first step that anyone would take towards membership at Grace Point Church. You might be thinking, why membership? Why can't I just be here? You can just be here. But there's something about a church membership that is important if you've decided that this is going to be your place for as long as God has you, whether that's for 6 months or 6 years or 60 years. And so part of the class will be to share why that's significant and what's important, what that offers you as a part of our body here. Or if you're ready to take that step towards membership directly, we'd encourage you to join us for that. It overlaps the Sunday school hour and the second service. We'd encourage you to go online or the app. You'll see a little registration thing there to sign up to let us know that you're coming. Or you can contact the office and let us know. That takes place next week. Check your email or our website for that information. Well, we kind of introduced over the last couple of weeks that we have are jump-starting short-term small groups, and we use that term because you're not committing for a year or 2 years to a small group. You're committing to about a 10-week journey, which is really only five sessions, because it's every other week that these short-term groups meet. We have a meeting all over the Twin Cities, six different locations, actually seven different locations. So there's probably a place close to where you live and at different days, different times. I know that many of you are already signed up for other groups, but certainly would invite you, especially if you're newer to Grace Point or in the past year, past months, and you're just looking to get to know a few others, or if you're not a part of any other studies, this would be a great opportunity for you to connect with some other Grace Point folks. So there are some sheets like this that are around. It has a nice little map so you can kind of see where the groups are meeting, see what the times are and the days. Big opportunity, and those are going to be starting soon. So we'd encourage you to, again, you can jump online on our app to see those, or you can grab one of those sheets and get registered for that. Well, finally, just mention that after this service, we launch our Sunday school classes. There's one in the gym that was with Dr. Randy Nelson on Christian apologetics, being able to better give an answer for our faith. There's one down in room 132, 133 on that end of the building on first floor called One Nation Under God, ? Kind of looking back to our foundations as a nation. And then Steve Porter and I will be leading a class downstairs in the fellowship hall called Identity Exchange, living fearlessly the identity that Christ has mapped out for you. So we invite you to check out one of those classes today. Well, I'm going to invite you to hear these words from Psalm 149 as we begin. Praise the Lord. Sing to the Lord a new song. His praise in the assembly of his faithful people. Let Israel rejoice in their maker. Let the people of Zion be glad in their king.
Well, let's do just that. So would you please join me in standing and worshiping our Lord with number 319, Immortal, Invisible, God Only Wise.
Resting, not hasting, and silent as a
may be seated. So after that wonderful segment of praise and worship to our Lord, good morning. My name is Mike Reynolds, if we have not met, or if you're new to Grace Point. I'm the choir director here at Grace Point. If you have any interest in choir, we just kicked off our season last Sunday, so there's plenty of time to join at a volunteer basis. We rehearse on Wednesdays from 6:45 to 8 p.m. If you have any interest, please reach out to me or Jason Schoolmeister's on the piano here. We would love to have you. Let us continue in worship with number 238, Jesus Shall Reign Where'er the Sun. Would you please pray with me? Heavenly Father, that is our desire, that every creature and every person on this earth honor you gratefully. Lord, you are our Savior, and we thank you for that. We worship you this morning, Lord, in everything we say and do. Lord, I ask that as the posture of our hearts, throughout our daily life, throughout our week, that we do all things for you. And Lord, we love to give back to you. So as we transition into this time of offering, Lord, we give these offerings to you because we love you and we wish to further your kingdom. Lord, I ask that you bless our offering this morning and allow it to be used for your kingdom. In your name I pray, amen.
Well, good morning, church. It's really great to see all of you here today. I want to take a quick moment to dismiss what we call point seekers, which following our time of worship is an extended time of gathering for our youngest. This is pre-K through first grade this morning, so they will be helped out those doors to another space. If you are new this morning, my name is Jared Carlson. I'm the senior pastor here at Grace Point, and really glad to have you with us, especially for those of you watching as well online. Let me invite you to grab your Bibles this morning. If you don't have one, there's some in the chair racks below you. I want to invite you to join with me as we continue in our study of looking at the New Testament book of Romans, a series we have titled Gospel Truth. Romans, if you're new to the Bibles in the New Testament, on the right side, following the four Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, then there's Acts, the story of the early church, and then Paul's letter to the Romans. As we begin this morning, I want to have us look at the first verse, which we covered last week. Paul, as he does with his other letters, is introducing himself, very traditional, a formal thing that one would do writing one of these letters in antiquity. And this letter that he's writing to the Romans, part of this introduction, as we learned last week, is that the church doesn't really know Paul. They've heard about him. He's been an active apostle planting churches throughout the area, but he had never been to Rome. And so he is anticipating and looking forward to the opportunity to go to Rome. And in light of that goal and hope of Paul's, he writes this letter, which is unique from all of Paul's other letters, because this is a letter to a church Paul didn't plant. He didn't start. And so he's, in a way, introducing himself. And he does that in the most simple of ways in verse 1. So let's take a look at that. We are going to be looking at verses 2 through 4 this morning. So we're definitely quickening our pace just a little bit, aren't we? Verse 1, Paul says this, Paul, a bondservant of Christ Jesus, called as an apostle. And I want us to especially focus on this latter part. Paul says he is set apart for the gospel of God. He's not set apart by a myriad of other things, not one of many. There's one thing that has set Paul's life apart, and that is the gospel of God. So what this tells us immediately is that this is a defining feature of Paul's life, the gospel. And this is another reason why Romans itself, as a theme, the gospel is carried throughout the entire letter. And it's important for us to think about this because a lot of us might think that the gospel only applies to those who don't know God. We might think of the gospel as something that's incredibly important. We've all benefited from it, but its priority seems to be for those who are outside the walls. But as we see from the very start of this letter, the gospel was the very thing that gave Paul his identity, who he understood himself to be. He says it to us in verse 1. He's a bondservant or a slave of Jesus. This is who I am. And it's because of the gospel of God, and it's the gospel that gives Paul a sense of purpose. Why do I do what I do out of this identity? For him, he understands that he is called to be an apostle, one who is to declare these things of God to others. But what this tells us, okay, here's Paul, an apostle. The gospel is the defining feature of his life. He's writing to a church that's not a whole lot different than us. This church has been founded and established for some 20 years up to the point by which Paul is writing this, which means that he's writing to a church like us who have been confessing and believing Jesus and living for Jesus for quite some time. And yet from the very beginning of this letter, what is going to run throughout this letter is this theme of the gospel, which tells us that the gospel is therefore more pervasive and more life-orientating than we might normally think. Because for many of us, we may consider this gospel as something that occurred in a moment in time. We might think of the gospel as this time where I profess Jesus as my Savior and I receive forgiveness of sins. And that is good. That is biblical. I want to absolutely affirm that, right? The Bible itself tells us, Paul's going to write later, Romans 10, verse 9, that if we confess Jesus as Lord, and we believe in our heart that God raised him from the dead, we will be what? Saved. The Apostle John says in 1 John 1:9 that if we confess our sins, recognizing that we are in desperate need of a Savior, and if we confess our sins, it is God who is faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. But what is also true is the danger of leaving the gospel behind to this one moment in time where I did this thing, I said this prayer, and I received something of profound importance. And so it's a danger to consider it as something that was just for that moment in time and forgetting that the gospel is to be applied to all of time. And what this means is that our confession of Jesus is supposed to lead to more than this get out of hell free card. As if I got what I needed, I'm good, and therefore, like we learned about last week, and we consider this idea of the bits and pieces of life, how we can categorize things. I got this, I'm good, now I can just go on and live my life. Rather, our confession of Jesus should lead to obedience. And that obedience should lead to a life of gratitude in which we yield all that we are to the lordship of Jesus. Peter in 1 Peter 3:15 says this, honor, another word he used, it could be used as sanctify, though the words mean the same, set apart Christ as Lord in your hearts. Well, what's the heart? The heart is the dwelling place of all of our desires, all of our feelings, all of our affections. The heart in the scripture is synonymous with our identity. In other words, it's who we are. I've heard somebody once say that the heart is the command center of the soul. And so the question is, are we giving Jesus the first of everything? Is Jesus the things by which we think about? Is Jesus the motivation and the influence behind our choices and our decisions? Is he the prime that kind of pumps our attitudes and our affections? This is why Paul writes in Colossians 3:17 that whatever you do, whatever it is, and whether it's in word or in deed, because all these things really are an outworking of that which resides in the heart, do it all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him. So let's turn and continue to look, I should say, at Romans 1. I want to read for us verses 2 through 4, which will be our focus and study this morning. Our sermon for today is titled, The Gospel Promised and Revealed. So let me read these verses for us. Paul writes, therefore, set apart the gospel, he set apart for the gospel of God, verse 2, which he promised beforehand through his prophets in the Holy Scriptures concerning his son who was born of a descendant of David according to the flesh, who was declared the son of God with power by the resurrection from the dead according to the spirit of holiness, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Would you join me in a word of prayer? Father in heaven, we thank you for the precious gift of what you have revealed to us, what you have shown us, primarily through your son, Jesus, an incredible gift of love, sacrificing yourself for us, paying the ultimate price for us, Lord, by dying on the cross for our sins. And so, Jesus, as we look into your word today and as we give consideration to this tremendous gospel, one that we have not only appreciated for the salvation of our soul, but one that continues to influence, Lord, and move us to a complete and total surrender, living under your lordship. I pray that you would encourage our hearts, that you'd prepare our minds for action, that we would be sober in all things, and that we would continue to fix our hope on the grace of God that will be revealed to us. The coming of Jesus Christ, our Lord. We thank you. It's in your precious name we pray. And all of God's people said, amen. As we look at verses 3 and 4, especially this morning, these verses are often considered perhaps an early Christian confession or creed, something that would have been known and shared, a kind of frequent articulation among the believers of what is true of us, why we are who we are as people. Now, The value of verses 3 and 4, and as you look at them now and why it's good to have the Bible on our lap, is as Paul is expressing this statement of who is the Son concerning his Son, and then it goes on to explain who he is. The value of these verses for us today is they provide a kind of clarity around the gospel. So what's the gospel? The gospel, a lot of us know this, is a word that simply means good news, right? The gospel is good news, and that's what it is. But our passage this morning is going to highlight some specific reasons why the gospel is good news. So I have 3 points for us this morning, or 3 what we might call reasons for why the gospel is good news, beginning with 1, if you're taking notes this morning. The gospel is good news because the gospel begins with revelation. Because the gospel begins with revelation. Now, what I mean here is that the gospel is good news because it begins with God. The gospel begins with God. Now, I've had people ask me before, Pastor, what's the gospel? You know, maybe it's just out of curiosity, what would someone like me say? Like, how have I come to understand it? All right, now I often tell people that the gospel is good news because God is the focal point of the message. God is the source of the revelation. Let's consider again, look back at verse 1. This is what Paul is saying when he says he's been set apart for the gospel. What does it say? Of God. That there is good news. Paul himself is basically saying, I have news that is good that I have to share with you. It's not new news. It's not my news. This good news is God. He'll say later in verse 16 that he's not ashamed of this good news. He uses the word gospel, for it is the very power of God, he says. So this is the starting point of the good news, that it is of God, that he is the source of message. Paul's not the source of it. The church isn't necessarily the source of it. Some organization isn't the source of it. I'm not the source of it. God is the source of the revelation. And so in some sense, the gospel is good news because God, as this revelation, was delighted to create us and to share with us his love. He didn't have to create. God was eternally satisfied in himself as Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. One God existing perfectly in 3 persons, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. But as we read in Genesis 1, verses 26 to 28, this is the beginning of the gospel, friends. It is God saying this, let us make men in our image. That is wonderful news. That's the beginning of God's desire and his love for you. Let's make man our image, in our likeness. And so God created him, male and female, and then God blessed them. This is the beginning of the gospel for your life. It is the good news that you are not an accident. That you are not the result of some cosmic accidental big bang resulting in slimy goo turning into monkeys, but that you are clearly made in his image, that you are not the byproduct of survival of the fittest and natural selection. The revelation of God is the good news that you are fearfully and wonderfully made. That before you're even born, friends, God knew you and had a plan for you, Jeremiah 1:5. Whereas Jesus himself says in Luke 12:7 that he numbers every hair on your head because he cares for you. He has established your every step, Proverbs 16:5. He has ordained and numbered your days, Psalm 139, verse 16. He has written you into his book of life, Revelation 3:5. And so the entire Bible, got that Bible in your lap right there, friends? The entire Bible is read like a love letter from our Creator God, who has become for us our provider, our sustainer. He is the very power of our salvation. And this love letter, from beginning to end, Genesis to Revelation, 66 books written by 40 different authors over a time period of 1,500 years in three different languages on three different continents, is written with a unified theme. And it is God's love for you, that God cares for you. And this very power of the gospel can be condensed into wonderful places. Some of them we know well, like John 3:16. And when we think about this story of God's love condensed into places like John 3:16, what does even John 3:16 say? How does it start? We've known this verse since we were babies. For God. When you think about what the gospel is, for God. This is the gospel. It's a gospel that begins with revelation for God. Nothing existed without him. Everything is dependent upon him and life itself and the created world. And friends, this is what Paul's going to write. While your Bible's in your laps, look with me to verse 20. Paul says in chapter 1, verse 20, "For since the creation of the world, his invisible attributes, his eternal power and divine nature have been clearly seen, being understood through what has been made, so they are without excuse." Paul's basically saying everything has its dependency in God by virtue of the fact that we exist, that you exist, that the sun rises and the sun sets, and the majesty of creation should be screaming out the majestic reality of God. And unless we supplant that with a foolishness that believes in an accidental slimy goo turning into monkeys, there is no other way to rationalize or believe in our existence. And if it's not an accidental slimy goo, then it is as a result of an intelligent designer, creator God. There is no third alternative. There is something greater than ourselves, and that greatness is either considered an accident or a purposeful design. That's it. And if it's a purposeful design, if that thing greater than ourselves has brought all things into existence, this love letter presents to us a God of revelation in which this creator and designer is full of relational love because he himself shows himself to exist as Father, Son, and Holy Spirit for God. And this God reveals himself in such a way that he shows himself to be a God of love who loves so much, for God so loved the world that he gave. And this God reveals himself to be one who is selfless and sacrificial. This is evidenced in the life of Jesus, his one and only son, who gave his one and only son. And whoever would believe in him will not perish, but have what? Why? Because he's eternal. And as he has always existed and as he always will exist, he shares that with all of you. We could condense this wonderful love letter into other verses like Luke 19:10, where Jesus says, "The Son of Man has come to seek and to save the lost, so that none will perish, but that all will have eternal life." This is the good news story of the Bible, friends. And you want to know what the good news is, friends? The good news is all contained in this Bible right here. This is good news, isn't it? Because this is of God. And the Word of God is a special revelation of God himself, so that we humble, fallible, mortal creatures of the dust can know and interact with and live in a relationship with our Creator. And And the gospel is God making that evident of himself to you. Now, the purpose behind this love, the entire reason why God gave, why he seeks to save the lost, the whole purpose behind this love is now further condensed in a passage like 2 Corinthians 5:21. Now, sometimes I describe the gospel, going back to the question of, hey, pastor, what do you think the gospel is? Sometimes I describe the gospel as being something that is presented to us in layers. And one significant layer is this layer of revelation. The good news is God and what we come to know about God. Another layer of this good news is the Bible and the specific function of God revealing himself to us by the way he breathed his truth into those who would write his words and capture his revelation as he continued to pierce into our existence and make himself known to us. Even 2 Peter chapter 1, verses 20 and 21 says that no word of prophecy ever came about by the intent or the will of a human, but it was breathed. They were moved by the very Spirit of God. And what the Bible captures is the evidence of this revelation. The Bible makes clearly known God's revelation to us, and it establishes a foundation for the revelation. Why is God choosing, when he doesn't have to make himself known to you? Why is this good news for us? As Paul says in 2 Corinthians 5:21, further condensing the gospel, he made him who knew no sin to be sin on our behalf, so that we might become the righteousness of God in him. This is why the gospel begins with God, and why this is of profound importance and glory and genuine delight for each one of us. We have a gift of hope that begins with God. And this is significant because the gospel, friends, is directly tied to the nature and character of God. You see, the God of Revelation is a God who is holy, holy, holy. No other attribute or characteristic of God is stated three times. There is no other attribute in all of Scripture where we hear God being declared as love, love, love. God is mercy, mercy, mercy. Only this characteristic, this attribute of holiness. And twice do we find that in the Scriptures. Once in the Old Testament, Isaiah chapter 6, verses 1 through 4. The other in the New Testament, in Revelation 4, 8. And in both of these occasions, it is coming from the angelic worship that is surrounding the throne of God. Now, on one hand, the three-time repetition and why it is of holiness and of nothing else is that it indicates the absolute distinctiveness and perfection of our triune God as Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Each are holy, holy, holy. On the other hand, the repetition is another way of indicating an emphasis, like placing an intensity of passion or affirmation upon something. Now, we know what that's like. When we are trying to get our point across, we might repeat something more than once. And we know what that's like. When we're trying to create a point of emphasis, we might repeat ourselves more than once. I won't do it a third time. But you get my point. Holy, holy, holy. Even in Jewish tradition, this three-peat often means completion or perfection. And all of this suggests that God, one God who exists eternally in three persons, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, are perfect. This suggests that they are perfect in their separation from any and all unworthy comparisons. We see this all throughout the Scriptures, like Isaiah 40, verse 18. The Lord God says, to whom will you like me? To what likeness will you compare me with? Of course, the answer is a resounding nothing. There is no one like you, for you alone are holy, completely distinct and separate from anything else. So God is holy in his distinctness from creation, and he is holy in his incorruptible and absolutely pure nature. And this God of revelation, who exists in absolute holiness, loves you. And he seeks after you so that he can share his righteousness with you and make you holy. He alone is worthy, because he alone can give that to you. It belongs to him. It is no one else's. Only God can save. And he has made himself known to us, most specifically in his word, the Bible. We refer to these as special revelations. And from this, he's made himself known to the living word, which is Jesus Christ himself. And this leads to our second point. The gospel is good news because the gospel is a promise realized. As we look to verse 2, Paul writes this. And again, I want to connect this to the end of verse 1 just so we understand. Paul is set apart for the gospel of God, verse 2, which he promised beforehand through his prophets in the Holy Scriptures. Now, this doesn't apply to everyone, but there are some who believe that verse 2 is almost like an insert. Like, Paul is introducing himself in verse 1, and right before he gets into this early creed that clarifies what the gospel of God is concerning his son, verse 3, what Paul seems to insert in verse 2 might be this little idea saying, look, you know that this has always existed. This gospel, as I said earlier, it's not new, it's not from me, it's not even about me, that this has always existed because it has existed with God who has existed in eternity, amen? And one of the things Paul's trying to say in verse 2 is, look, he promised these things a long time ago, like in the prophets in the Holy Scriptures. Now, that's just a loose way of saying all of the Old Testament. God has been revealing himself through these promises. Let's take a look at this. Now, what's important for Paul is that we understand, as I just said, God has always been revealing himself, and his love is captured in many promises now realized in Christ. That's concerning his son, verse 3. Now, what are these promises? This is important for us to understand. Let's just take, for instance, the great promise of Genesis 3:15. The very first time the gospel was promised in the Old Testament was in the context of a curse, where Adam and Eve disobeyed God from a lie of Satan. They exchanged the truth and the glory of God. Where are we going to hear that language again? Some of you familiar with Romans? Okay, you look ahead even right now. If you look, verse 23, professing to be wise, they became fools. They lived in the presence of the Almighty God and Creator. Full and complete exposure to the revelation and the understanding of truth. This is Adam and Eve. And Paul, kind of comparing us as the recipients of this spiritual inheritance, like Adam and Eve, Paul is saying in verse 23, they exchanged the glory, they professed to be wise, but they became fools and exchanged the glory of God for what he basically says is a lie. And Adam and Eve, they disobeyed God, they exchanged that profound truth for a what? For a lie. What was that lie? It was essentially, you can be God yourself, right? You can remove God from the throne of your heart, and you can sit there. What do you even need him for? And a lot of us seem to be living that way even today, don't we? That's why Peter in 1 Peter 3:15 says, honor or set apart Christ as Lord over your heart. okay? But we see this gospel at the very beginning. Listen to what God declares. So God, as a result of this sin, judgment is placed upon us, including Satan himself. God is judging, for he alone is holy. And in his judgment of Satan, he says this, I will put enmity between you and the woman, and between your seed and her seed. He shall bruise you on the head, meaning the one who comes from the woman will deliver a fatal blow. But you, speaking to the serpent, the snake, the devil, you will bruise him on the heel. You will do something that you think will afflict pain, but it's not going to amount to anything. All right, so this is a foreshadowing. This is a promise being given of the Messiah to come who is going to deliver victory over the devil. Or consider the Abrahamic covenant of Genesis 12. God promises to Abraham that he will bless him and he will make him father of a great nation. God says to Abraham in chapter 12, verse 3, and in you, all the families of the earth will be blessed. Why? Why will the world be blessed through this group that will become the nation of Israel? Is it because Israel is going to provide the world with some economic prosperity? Is it because Israel is going to be the means by which, through military strength, they kind of order and orchestrate peace over the world? Is it through some incredible technological advancement that Israel is going to establish something that the whole world is going to say, oh, everything's great now? No. Through you and this nation is going to come one who is going to deliver that fatal death blow to the one in which judgment is upon us all. And he is going to be victorious. And this covenant of promise is reaffirmed again to David, 2 Samuel 7. We know it as the Davidic covenant. And in this promise, there's a foreshadowing of one, the Lord says to David, that from your family, meaning the offspring, which leads to Jesus, there's going to be one who's going to sit on the throne over the people of God. There are thousands of promises in the scriptures that build a foundation of gospel hope. We could consider Abraham's sacrifice of Isaac. And in Abraham's obedience, the Lord instead, God provides a ram. I'm going to take it for you. We could consider the Exodus and how God delivered his people from death through the blood of a spotless lamb. These are miraculous stories that present a picture of redemption that would eventually come in a more complete and perfect form. And all of these promises are pointing to us. They're calling out to us that God is at work to restore and to reclaim what rightfully belongs to him. But in addition to these promises are the many prophecies that build up our anticipation for this gospel hope. You know, just as an example, in the scriptures, there are 330 prophecies in the Old Testament concerning the Messiah, Jesus of Nazareth, perfectly fulfills each and every one of those prophecies. Born in Bethlehem, born of a virgin, nailed to a cross, no bone in his body broken. Now here's an amazing truth, friends. As we consider all of Scripture, in the New Testament, one out of every 30 verses makes some kind of reference to the return of Christ. That's how much frequency there is that Jesus is coming again. And if Jesus fulfilled all those Old Testament prophecies, you can be sure that we will all realize the promise of his second coming. And what we need to answer is the question, are you ready? Are you ready? Lastly, the gospel is good news because the gospel is righteousness received. This gospel that has always been presented to us in the scriptures, verse 2, verse 3, now concerning his son. Everything's about Jesus. From Genesis on, everything's pointing us to Jesus. How he was born a descendant of David. That's the fulfillment of the Davidic covenant. According to the flesh, he was declared the Son of God with power by the resurrection from the dead. According to the Spirit of holiness, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Verses 3 and 4 are what the gospel is all about. It's about God, who is incorruptible and incomparable, giving to us in Jesus the righteousness that we desperately need. He gives to us what we could never acquire or achieve on our own. And that's what makes the gospel so precious and so transformative. The gospel is about a person, Jesus Christ. The gospel is not an idea or concept. It's definitely not about a method or even an organization. It is God entering into human history in a real way and proving the full extent of his love through the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. And the reason why the gospel is so extravagant and attractive is because God did what only God can do. He came down to us, verse 3 says, and he was born according to the flesh. He did this to be like us in every way. This God of revelation wanted to be a God that we could relate to, that we could understand and know. And in a very personal way, he represents the nature of our flesh and his humanity. But Christ was not bound to flesh and death. Because, as it says in verse 4, according to the spirit of holiness, Jesus was thoroughly righteous. So in flesh, he was like us in every way. But in spirit and in heart, he was unlike us, for he was of God. For he is God. Amen. And therefore, he was completely righteous. And according to the spirit of holiness, he met every standard and expectation of a holy, holy, holy God. And therefore, he also is incorruptible and he's incomparable. And the resurrection is the validation of his sonship from all eternity. Peter writes in 1 Peter 1:20, he has existed. He who existed from the beginning of time has now come to us to make himself known to us for our sake. Well, who is he? Well, Hebrews chapter 1 tells us that this God as Son, by which all things have been created and made, assumed a better name. He assumed the name of Jesus. Paul tells us in Philippians chapter 2 that he became obedient in this flesh to the point of death, even death on a cross. And for that reason, God highly exalted him and gave him a name that is above every other name. And so the resurrection is the validation of his sonship, Jesus the Christ, the living one, who has existed from all eternity because sin could not keep him in the grave. This is the power of the resurrection of the dead. All of this is why Paul will later write in Romans 5:8, another succinct statement of the gospel. God proves his love for you, that while you are still a sinner, Christ came and he died for us. But this begs a question, and a most important question: what is sin? Now, we might answer this question by coming up with a whole list of vices and poor choices to say, well, this is sin. But sin is ultimately anything that robs God from the glory that he rightfully deserves. So at any time in which our thoughts or our actions or our attitudes and desires amplify self over God, we are sinning. And when we think of it in this way, we quickly realize just how desperate our situation really is, don't we? Because I'll be the first one to say among all of you, I love myself a lot. And it's not something I'm proud of. And as much as I hate the pride of my heart that puts myself over many people, including my own family sometimes, God hates that pride even more. And so it can be humbling to consider how much of my life is about me and not about God. This is also why the gospel is for all of us. As I said early this morning, it's not just for those out there who perhaps don't believe. We all need to remember the profound revelation of God who has promised to us his mercy and grace in Jesus. And this is why our lives are to be lived in humble obedience and grateful adoration for all that he has done, that you would still consider me your very own when you know the condition of my heart. The gospel is not only about a moment in time, it's also about the remainder of our time. Are we giving to God the entirety of our lives? Is he running the command center of our soul? The gospel of God is the very power of God because Jesus died for our sins and gives to us his righteousness. We are saved because we believe. We believe in the revelation of God. We believe in the promises of God. And we believe in a righteousness given, not a righteousness that we earn. The gospel is simple and profound, friends. For God so loved the world that he gave his only son, that whoever would believe in him will not perish, but have everlasting life. Thanks be to God for Jesus and the sanctifying work of the Spirit of holiness that saves us from our sins, leads us into righteousness both now and forevermore. Let me invite you to stand with Mike as we continue in our time of worship this morning. To stay standing for a moment as I give us this closing benediction. And then we're going to, for those of you watching online, we're going to say farewell. We have an important update from one of our global partners that will be for us here this morning alone. So after the benediction, you can be seated for just like a minute. It'll be real short, and then we'll dismiss you on your way. But let me leave us with this from Colossians chapter 1. It was the Father's good pleasure for all the fullness to dwell in him, and through him to reconcile all things to himself, having made peace through the blood of his cross. Through him, I say, whether things on earth or things in heaven, thanks be to God, the finishing work of Christ, and the promise, Philippians 1:6, that he is going to make all things complete, that he who began a good work in you will bring to completion in Christ Jesus. May God bless you and encourage you. Please be seated for just a quick moment. Thanks for being with us today.